they want to hurt. Dog.
Yeah.
They just want to hurt.
They just want to hurt.
They just want to hurt these evil people. But we're not evil. We are a delight.
And we are someplace underneath. I'm not a Jean.
I'm Amber Nelson.
Hi, everybody. What is wrong with people?
Yes, that's what we're all thinking. What is wrong with people?
Folks,
because I got
what's wrong with everyone?
What's wrong? I got my phone stolen, and I was like, thank God I didn't have any spicy photos on there. And, you know, Natalie and I were just chatting.
Yeah, and just, you know, you were providing this point against what I just said, which is you were watching some guy laugh about how, oh, if you put spicy photos on your phone and they get, you know, if they end up on the internet, like, it's your fault. And I also usually say to people, myself included, don't put any on your phone, but for not the reason that it's your fault, but because guys like that or people like that exist where they'll laugh at it and think it's funny if you get hacked and your shit goes somewhere.
Yeah.
So it's better to just not ever have any on your phone.
No.
Unfortunately.
And like, so many guys, like if a guy on Hinge or Tinder or whatever says, like, send me a spicy photo, I just delete him.
Oh my God.
Because who are you? You don't get to see my hole.
There's been a rash of... I think we've probably talked about it on the stream before, but there's been a rash of young men or older minors who are getting sextorted a lot of times from people outside of the country who are masking as like a pretty young girl, getting them to send nudes of themselves and then demanding money or with like threats of saying like, I'll post this to all your family and friends if you don't like get me money and stuff.
Oh my
like
God,
that.
But it's yeah. A guy, right?
A lot of times it's men. Yeah.
Yeah. It's not the same, though. It's like, oh, no, I saw Steve's balls. That's not as same as, like...
I mean, it's still extremely traumatizing to the point where one of those kids died by suicide. But they ended up convicting the guys who were doing the scam. I think they were based out of Africa or somewhere. But they ended up convicting... They, like, took them to America and like,
gave good. Them...
They worked with the government of the country to bring them in and... Charge them.
Good. I mean, like, we're discussing on today's case, this woman died by suicide, and her husband, like, even though he didn't pull the trigger, like, you can emotionally condemn someone till that point, and I think you should be held accountable.
Yes. Yeah. We're going back to Mica Miller today because I really think it's important to talk about a bigger epidemic around this culture that we have in the U.S. specifically, but other places, too. I'm really tired of it. This sort of socially acceptable yet vile, toxic soup of these men of the cloth.
Right, because they're supposed to be the leaders, the spiritual leaders. They're supposed to be pretty pure, and like we have to follow them.
Yeah,
and, you know, and especially like as a woman in these communities, I'm expected to like be subservient to them, and he's my leader, and I give him my bank account and my body.
Sometimes your body and your whole life. And we've really just continued to perpetuate this as an acceptable practice in this country, and I'm really sick of it. Because I gotta tell you, guys like John Paul Miller, nobody, but specifically guys like John Paul Miller, do not talk to God. Guys like John Paul Miller don't even have insight or something that's gonna make you a better person inside of them. They're just pieces of shit who we pedestal, and then they fucking ruin everyone's lives, and everybody goes, well, he sinned. You know, you gotta forgive him because he's up there on the little pulpit. I'm giving a sub. Yes, I'm making wide sweeping. I'm blaming the South.
I mean, understandable. Like, I was just in Mississippi, and I was like, oh, I'm never coming back here again. A, because I had to go to one of those churches where I couldn't speak. You know, it's very, very... very Southern Baptist, and I was like, why am I here giving you my time and money and attention? And I can't even speak. I'm going to Tokyo. I'm going to the Bahamas. I'm going on safari. Never here again.
Yeah. Who's clamoring to go to Mississippi?
Nobody. Fucking nobody.
Corrupt pastors and politicians. That's who's clamoring to go because they want to steal your fucking money.
You get him, Natalie.
XJ Slays. don't keep spices, and if you send spices, make sure you're okay with people seeing them. I mean, I agree, except like in the case we're about to talk about, Mica Miller sent that to her husband because she did in fact send one to her husband that he ultimately posted on Facebook when he was throwing a tantrum. The pastor that we're going to speak about.
And of course she gets blamed in those little communities. Well, she shouldn't have sent it. This is the husband. She's supposed to do what he tells her, right? In these fucking little communities.
Also, XJ Slays, you came for tears. Never watched SPUN, but I love Amber Nye. Thank you so much. I am sorry. This is a little bit differently toned.
Oh, and head jellies. Oh, I live in Mississippi, but yeah, it does suck, so I can't really take up for it. I'm sorry. I don't mean the whole state of Mississippi. I just mean, like, the church I went to and the community that's very Southern, that's very religious, that's very the man is the head, the preacher's the head. You do everything they say.
My anger is because there's good people in Mississippi.
Yes.
That's what makes me mad. I don't think that, actually, it's probably gorgeous there. I've never literally driven through because it's terrifying to me.
It is beautiful.
I'm doing the thing that people who live out in the woods say about cities, where I'm just like, I would never go there.
Yeah.
No, but I am terrified of deep woods. They're very
scary. Of course,
scary.
Absolutely. And yeah, so we're talking a lot about like people in religious affiliations who can just literally quite get away with murder.
Oh man, this case is why it makes me so angry. And we're watching this happen alongside. I was going to also talk about the Chad Daybell trial, which is going on because it's part of stuff that we've covered on the show and we will be covering on the show for the next season. But this kind of just took over my last couple weeks because how much it's blowing my mind that this has gotten to this point. And it's not even just John Paul Miller kept all this a secret and affected this woman and secretly in his marriage. He's been doing this for decades with other women.
Yeah.
Openly and talking about it on the pulpit, just boldly.
He had a first wife who looked a lot like Mica Miller.
Oh, yeah, we will.
That's really creepy to me.
Yeah, it's, you know, that's not reaching even. Like, they look very, very similar. So, this is a culture that sort of has lifted him up. And, you know, this is sort of a combination of nature and nurture most of the time. But part of the nurture also comes from his father, who is also convicted of a bunch of sex crimes against little boys in, I think, Pakistan.
Yeah.
But don't worry. He's just running a Bible college here in the States. He's fine. So don't, if you were worried about how he's doing, he's fine. He's back here.
Still in leadership, still with his baby boy.
Yeah, and also his family helped John Paul Miller start the church where all of this happened. So John Paul Miller is the main pastor of this church called Solid Rock, and he also is the owner of it. It's his little playground. That's essentially what it is. It is a place for him to just live out his sexual deviance fantasies, and also it's his personal piggy bank because he's very wealthy from this church. He has a private jet. He has a Corvette. He has an estate that he was trying to take away from Mica at the end of her life when she was filing for divorce, by the way.
All right. Oh, no, doesn't have a cold plunge? We can't forget about the cold plunge, Natalie.
Oh, it was mentioned in the obituary that he wrote for her.
Yeah. Sorry, I mean to laugh and like,
no, I get it. It is insane.
Because he wrote the obituary and he's like, my husband's so perfect and wonderful. And
yeah.
She has an ice bath.
This is not an exaggeration. If you guys weren't watching the show last week, go check it out. You can find it anywhere. But if you go look up Mica Miller's obituary, it was written by the man who had tortured her for her entire life, basically. And it's all about how much she loved her amazing husband. He wrote it himself. That'd be like if like I sent you to your death and then was like, Amber just always wanted to say how her co-host was the smartest and prettiest little girl she's ever seen.
And you are, Natalie.
Oh, thank you. See, I don't have to do that. I don't have to kill you because you could just say it. I want to write an obituary.
That's right.
Yeah. So the FBI is now getting involved in this case because there are a lot of questions around her death. There are really wild kind of out of left field a little bit conspiracies going around the death. As it stands now, the evidence that we have, it almost definitely was a suicide. People are speculating that the 911 call that she made right before she did it was AI, and there was like people following her, and I understand that feeling because this feels so wrong. And it might, I mean, it's not out of the realm of possibility, but right now there isn't any evidence of that. It's just feelings, you know? So I do think at this time she probably did die by suicide, right? But because of this laundry list of literally crimes that he was committing against her for decades is now coming to light. I don't know if that's why the local police are bringing the FBI in, but then, you know, of course, we're going to get into the speculations about, is the police department corrupt? And we, again, don't know that, but we have seen time and time again where a pastor does get away with shit locally, especially a wealthy pastor, especially like a wealthy family who everybody knows. We go back to, what's his name? Ginger.
Oh, with the jets. So he said God gave him his jet?
No, not him. Not a preacher. Come on, you guys. Somebody pull it out for me. The family, the boat crash, the woman died, then we found all the father's crimes out. Oh, you guys, come on.
Boat crash, woman died, father, I know it's crime.
Somebody in the chat's gonna tell me immediately what
Titanic.
That is.
Titanic.
The Titanic.
Boat.
What's that?
Crash.
Murdoch. Murdoch, thank you.
There we go.
Thank you. The Murdoch family. Legacy Southern family ran the little area that they were in, committed decades of crimes, just horrible people, and only are just now dealing with the consequences of that, because these kind of people are sort of protected, especially right. In those little communities where,
well, if you have money, I mean, you can get away with murder.
I mean, quite literally, yes. Yeah. So I'm feeling a little right now pessimistic about the chances that he's gonna face charges, not because there's not a mountain of evidence, but because this behavior has been accepted and normalized for so long, especially, I mean, in general, but in this community specifically, I don't know what charges they're going to get to stick to him, but he deserves to be off the streets. He is not a good man. He shouldn't, obviously, people are like the bare minimum, they don't want him to be up on the pulpit. That's not enough to me.
No, because he's just going to do this again. He's going to get another lookalike.
Oh, yeah. He's not going to just suddenly, like, because every time that he would openly admit to all these horrible things, my past sins. That's not what that is. We have to get past this idea of people committing crimes like this as sins that just need absolved and forgiven. That's not how this works, especially in the kind of behavior that he exhibits, which is like sexual torture, sexual abuse. That's not something that just goes away in people.
No.
It's going to continue. It's a pattern that does not stop, and we don't know how to stop it with science right now. So you can't just say, oh, I'm sorry, oopsie, and then just continue on like he's, even if he does feel vaguely sorry, which I don't think he does. That's not enough.
But he asked for forgiveness, Natalie, so.
Ooh, I'm getting heated. So, yes, there are, there's just a multitude of evidence-based, I don't know what else to say other than crimes that he committed against her. And I'm like, we're talking like stalking, extortion, SA, physical abuse, psychological torture. It's insane. And it's so open. I want to go through a little bit of his life because we have to stop allowing this shit to happen publicly and openly.
Yeah, how do we start? So the father, Pakistan, sex crimes against children, who raised the son. So Lord knows what kind of house that was.
Yeah, I mean, we can learn about people's crimes through their upbringing. Not necessarily, oh, it's his dad's fault, but his dad very much definitely fucking traumatized him, I imagine, somewhere, shape, or form. I don't think his dad's cool.
No.
That's what I would go on. We don't even have time to go into that entire backstory. I have a big list of things I want to bring up. It's only going to be like a fraction of shit that has come out from this story. And it is, I don't think it's that uncommon. I don't think that this doesn't happen all the time.
No, Finnelagel says he's sorry he's been called out. Yeah, he's sorry he got caught.
He's still in full self-pity mode.
He doesn't give a shit. He's going to do it again and again.
I don't think we're even going to get to the memorial service he held for her, but I recommend you guys go look it up because if nothing else, that man needs to be in an institution. He is out of his mind.
He put her in an institution.
Oh, yeah. Oh, he did. He did. So when he did that memorial service, her entire family said, we want nothing to do with this. They had their own separate memorial service for her at the beach, away from his gross church. But he still held it, and a bunch of people from the church went, because there's still people going to that church right now. Even though he's not technically pastoring, whatever, it doesn't matter. It's his church. So I'm gonna go through some basics about the, like, before, how did we get here? It wasn't overnight. So J.P. Miller has, he goes by J.P., he has a criminal history. First off, somewhere around 1998, he was indicted on charges of assault and battery of a high and aggravated nature.
Shit.
So this was a time, he was a young adult at this point, and he apparently charged at a woman trying to run her over with his car. There's not a lot of other details about this.
I mean, if it's in 1998, to be honest, to be charged with assault in the 90s probably means it was pretty fucking bad, because
he tried to run a chico. He tried to run somebody he was mad at over.
Yeah, I mean, if you caught the Woodstock 99, you get an example of, like, that sort of masculinity.
Yeah,
you
know, it was pretty bad.
Like, nobody really
got
charged with that shit. So he must have done, I mean, he tried to run a woman over with a car. That's horrible.
Yeah, and Truffle Fry, that's the one where he said he was trying to raise her from the dead, right? Yes, the memorial service that J.P. Miller held for Mica, he goes on to say he tried to lay with her body and tried to raise her from the dead. I hate him so much. I don't know if you can tell. I'm mad.
Yeah, and I wish, like, this is important for us to talk about, because if it's just this one case now, like, how many cases throughout history were just like this?
That, or just current.
Got swept under the rug, or current.
So in 2000, John Paul Miller marries his first wife, who goes by Allison or Allie. And I bring her up. Here's her picture of her. I bring her up because she has come forward and is assisting Mica's family. If you'll note, this is a modern picture of her. She looks alarmingly similar to Mica. She's so his first wife is closer to JP's actual age. So Mica is 14 years younger. But they look like they could be related. So I'm bringing her up because she has come forward and she is supporting the family. So that they got married in 2000, right? April 13th, 2003, John Paul Miller is found guilty of John Paul Miller is found guilty of aggravated assault with a deadly weapon and knowingly causing property damage in excess of $300. So he's married. He's a nice little married man. By the way, this isn't being reported a lot on a lot of the stories. He and this first wife have 5 children. One of them was from somebody else out of wedlock, and there's very little else said about it.
I didn't know about that.
Yes. So 4 of them are Allison's bio children. One she raised as her own, apparently, not her kid. So he's a dog. He's a bit of a dog. So this is 2003 when he gets that second aggravated assault charge. February 28, 2005, another charge. John Paul Miller is charged with domestic assault and battery, bodily harm. So that's 2005, right? This is when Mica herself is a little girl.
Was she like 6 years old at this time or something?
She was born in 1994, so she would have been 11.
Okay.
He is a young adult, but he's an adult who's married, right? So the time between 2007 and 2009 is when Mica starts getting integrated with John Paul and this church, because her family moves from Myrtle Beach, her family moves from Kansas, I should say, to Myrtle Beach. And so they get involved in this church because traditionally that's where people think that they can go to take kids and that for them to be safe. Obviously, that's very not true a lot of the time. Not just here. Yeah, Strange Rock. I'm stuck thinking about how when he received his first assault charge, Mica is 4 years old. Yeah. Yep. Yep. So she is meeting JP around her 14th birthday. Or, I'm sorry, close to her 15th birthday. She's like 14-ish when they meet. They meet because she goes to the church that he owns and lords over. And she knows him from the youth ministry. So that's where we are. That's where we're having these two people meet each other.
So in her eyes, she's like, oh, he's a trusted adult. He's a man of God, and God is good, and he works for God, so I should trust him with my life.
Yes. Yes. It's pretty much kind of agreed upon with people who were around this as it was happening that he was actively grooming her at this time. He became fixated on her, possibly because she looked like a child version of his wife. Anyway, so during these years, these first years when her family first moves to Myrtle Beach, Mica, as a minor, is working in the church. She gets really invested in the church. She really loves the community. She is very spiritual. She wants to be a part of stuff. And so she's working in the church, and she becomes enmeshed with JP's family and is often ending up babysitting his children and working other ways in the church. And so she is not that much older than his kids, like especially the oldest ones, but the younger kids she was babysitting from, you know, 15 years old on, maybe 16. So she's going to their home. And this enmeshment is largely due to his grooming and apparent fixation on her, according to many people who were there to witness it, right? So he becomes fixated on Mica. And other kids, by the way. So 2012, Mica marries a man named Jeremy. Mica is still a teenager at this time. She would have, I don't know what the day of their marriage was, but she turned 18 in March of that year. So she's a little Pisces girly. She got married the year she turned 18. According to multiple sources, the husband that she got married to, Jeremy, was John Paul's boy, his BFF. There's not much known about this guy. I found that he seems to be working in another church now, currently, but I don't want to implicate him in anything. I don't also know if he's closer to JP's age or if he's closer to Micah's age. Did JP somehow instigate this relationship in the first place? I'm not sure, because at this point, JP is still married to his first wife.
With five kids.
I think they were five kids by that point. I'm not sure what all the birthdays are, but so he's still married to his first wife. His best friend and Mica end up, I guess, falling in love and getting married when Mica is barely an adult, right? Many people often referred to Jeremy as JP's best friend at the time. And guess who officiated Micah's first wedding? John Paul Miller did. We have a picture of it. That is JP marrying Mica as an 18-year-old to her first husband.
He looks young.
I think he might be.
He looks like 20.
He looks like he, I do feel like he might be closer to Micah's age.
Yeah.
And this was some weird, in my mind, I'm just going off of vibes. This was some weird sexual, like, control thing that he was doing with Mica. Like putting, and here's another wider shot of their wedding. You can see JP up at the top there, the pulpit, and her husband is also up there, but he's just staring right down at her, and man, are those some 2012 bridal dresses, some bridesmaids dresses right there. That is a look.
Oh, that, yeah, that seafoam color.
That seafoam, that cut, that hair, the hair too. Very 2012.
You're right. This is like a weird sexual fetish. Like, you got to marry her off at like 17, 18, and we got to pick out the guy, get her. Like, A, it's like a get her out of my house.
But I think with this, to me, the way that my mind is seeing it, and this is, again, just vibes, he is sexually obsessed with Mica at this point, and he feels like he can't be with her, and so he uses this guy as, like, a stand-in for him, and he feels like sexual control over Mica because he helped choose her husband. That's my thoughts. It's not, there's nothing, nobody right. said that. That's just how I feel. So he marries Mica off at age 18 in 2012.
Oh, M3CHEman says he probably asked his friend about the sex.
Yeah, I mean,
yeah, that's a good probably. You know, we're just talking about vibes here, but
It doesn't feel like that's out of the realm of possibility after everything that we know about him.
And this is right around the age of, like, recording stuff. She could have been recorded without her knowing.
God knows. I mean, God knows. Having Michael grow 420, he steals his friend's wife. He does. And it's really fascinating because I don't know if we'll even get to that sermon, but a lot of his sermons, he talks about other people's stories that he is very clearly talking about himself, but he's putting it in third person. Girl, I can't. Okay, so we might not even get to that today. So in 2015, John Paul's first wife, Allie, who we've already mentioned, files for divorce from JP. Over the next couple of years, in the process of filing for that divorce, Allison alleges a great many things trying to get alimony. So because you have to report certain things, she was describing things that happened in their marriage. So in this affidavit, she alleges him of engaging in sex acts with minors younger than 16 and being addicted to prostitutes. She also claims that Miller was caught in an affair with Mica in 2015 while she was working as their babysitter and married to his then best friend, Jeremy. So, yes, Mica has been caught. I don't know what to say. They were having an affair, and I hate using that word affair because it doesn't feel right to me. But she isn't an adult at this point. She is in her very early 20s, and she's married. So they're calling it an affair. And this is also a quote from her affidavit and when she was seeking alimony in 2017. Our marriage and my husband's career were less than stable at the time because at the time my husband's affair was discovered, he had previously admitted to both me and our congregation that he had an addiction to prostitution. He had also confessed to me and other staff members of the church that he had sexual encounters with young females from the church who were under the age of 16. So she's saying he's been doing this for a long time, and also saying that he committed crimes that were not ever dealt with.
So I guess like just having, you know, sexual relations with children, I mean, that's illegal, but I guess if you do it under church guides,
that you are pastoring over.
You're pastoring over.
Not saying over, I talk to God.
Yeah, not only is it legal, but you get money. You also get their parents' money.
Yeah. Yeah. So, you know, again, 2015, Mica and JP are having an affair, and I'm using air quotes because I question whether that sexual relationship really would have just begun in 2015. That seems unlikely to me. And also that he groomed her and he was her pastor since childhood. It doesn't feel like an affair to me, even if she's an adult at this point. Whatever. So the congregation finds out. It's a huge scandal, of course. As this is all coming out in 2015, John Paul Miller writes a letter to the church asking for forgiveness for this. According to multiple members of the church at the time, elders told them, you're not a good Christian if you don't have forgiveness.
What? Wait, they told that to the congregation?
So the elders in the church, and there's a couple of them that have been called out for enabling his behavior, basically said, he wrote this letter saying, I'm really sorry about this affair I had with this little girl who grew up and I married her off and I had an affair with her, even though I'm the pastor, please forgive me. And then all of the other elders in the church said, if you don't forgive him, are you really a good Christian?
So they can keep abusing you. And if you stand up and say, no, well, you're not a good Christian. He's a good Christian, though.
Because he said sorry.
Because he said he was sorry. Meanwhile, if a woman did this, a woman pastor was just like cheating on the husbands, having extramarital affair, even though she was cheating on him. But if a woman was a pastor doing this, there's no forgiveness for her.
Ark of Ark, just think, guys. These type of people get to go to heaven. Well, yeah, we make a lot of jokes about that because
that's my version.
We got
of hell.
Like Josh Duggar, yeah. We got Chad Daybell, we got the 144,000, which all seemed to be pretty not fun to hang out with. And then your great question was, well, what if it's one of their heavens is chasing you around in a warehouse? Do you have to go there?
That's where my you hell. Go.
So sometime, this is all 2015. The marriage is dissolving. This affair is found out. There's a huge scandal. Some people do leave the church, respectfully. They hear these things and they're like, oh, I'm gonna go to some other church. But a bunch of people still stay. During this time period, in most cases, I would feel bad about playing this because it's an obviously humiliating video and it looks like someone having some kind of mental break, but honestly, fuck this guy. he deserves this. So I don't know if you've seen this, but this is body cam footage of John Paul Miller during the time period of his first divorce.
He keeps having these mental breaks. What the fuck is wrong with this guy? I mean, not, sorry, I don't want to take that back. If you keep, why is he a pastor?
I mean,
I shouldn't have said that.
You want to play that video?
JP. You all right, man? You okay? Huh? You okay? What's the matter? Huh? What's the matter?
This one's bananas. Makes me go crazy.
Is somebody helping you? Oh, okay.
I thought I was going to see Jesus.
Okay. But you got Mark coming?
Somebody called him, I think.
Okay.
I'm going to get you, baby. I'm going to see Jesus. Because he ends biting me everywhere.
Is she a medication? Something they gave you?
Yeah,
was he driving under this?
Can you want me to make sure Mark's coming?
Yeah, I don't know his phone. I don't have the phone on me.
But somebody's called him, right?
Yeah, the lady across the street called.
Okay. All right.
All right. Okay.
Wait, this can go on. This goes on for quite a while. We don't really have time to watch.
Hey, JP.
The fact that he was even driving under like that, you have to be taken away. Like, what the fuck is wrong? He's obviously on drugs.
Yeah. And faith is a hell of a drug, brush. Yeah. obviously, in a normal situation, I would feel very sad for that person. They were, like, going through something really dark. But first off, fuck this guy.
Yeah.
Also, you can't really hear unless you listen a bunch of times, but he's talking about... He started a new medication and he thought he was going to meet Jesus. He just wants to meet Jesus. He thinks ants are crawling on him. He called his, he wants his dad to show up and his dad is being called. And I don't think it's fake. I think maybe he is actually on drugs,
no,
right?
No, that's pretty real. I mean, that kind of behavior means, okay, you should be taken care of. You should be put away somewhere where you're like monitored and supervised and helped and not just like released back into the wild to preach again.
Yeah, and you saying that you need cared for, need help, is kind of interesting because I do think that is what he's doing. I think that, yeah, I think he did take drugs, whether or not it was like a medication or not. This is a man who is being accused of really fucked up things in this time period. He's going through a divorce, he is having an affair, and what better way than to, what better way to receive pity
than to be a meepy boy?
To go, I'm really sad. I just want to go to the mirror. I want to see Jesus, you guys. And later on in that video, goes on for like 5 minutes. He just goes, you've always taken care of me. Thank you guys so much. And then they hold water up to his mouth and he goes like. Yes, I would, weed wife, I would definitely call it a narcissistic spiral.
Right, because they know, and I've definitely met some people like this, they know when to sort of pull back and be like, I'm scared, and then just know everybody's going to like rally around and
exactly.
Help them, and like, we all need to come together. Like, they're manipulators, narcissists.
Yeah, and weed wife also, like, you saw a man, like, a grown man throw himself on the floor, choking on his own saliva, thrashing about. In that same manner, I've also seen this not through a religious scope like a pastor, actually quite the opposite, but I knew somebody like this as well who would act this way after people got mad or would like, he caused a bunch of damage. He would just like throw himself and like go into these like, it was completely self pity.
Right.
Moves. Even if these kind of people feel actually bad, it is somebody come fix my problems for me. I don't feel bad for me.
Mm-hmm.
So that's my take on that video personally.
Damn.
So this is happening 2015, 2016 time period. 2017, JP weds Mica. Mica is 23 years old, and JP is around, I think, I want to say 37 at this point, with five children. Oldest child is very close to Micah's age. But she takes this role on. She, by all accounts, was ready to be a stepmom, loved the kids, cared about them.
Stepmom to five kids. That's not just one or two kids. Five at the whole ass family.
And she's been caring for a lot of those kids since she was like 15 years old. So she, it's another emotional manipulation.
Because if she leaves him, you're not just leaving your husband, you're leaving these five little tiny souls behind. And what are they going to do without a mother?
I know. It's a me, Emily, a mantrum. It's a mantrum. A man's child tantrum. Very good. So they get married. God knows what happens during this time period. But we do know, just coincidentally, right after they're married in 2017, she's diagnosed with bipolar and schizophrenia.
Whoa.
Never shown signs of that. Nobody ever suspected she had those issues. But as soon as they're married, schizophrenia happens. And look, to be fair, a lot of times schizophrenia does appear in your early 20s. There is no evidence that she was experiencing that.
If the only person that's reporting this mental break is this guy,
the abusive husband,
the abusive guy who's laying on the grass crying, saying like she's a schizophrenic,
yeah,
was like her parents, did they come step in and say no, she's not?
I mean, this is the way a manipulative person works. Their family despised him, right? But they're not, as their wedding, their marriage starts, they're not looking for all of the signs. They're also letting her be in a grown woman in the situation.
Right.
But I will say, over the last couple years, they have progressively become more and more vocal. Even before this horrible tragedy happened, the family was fighting for her. And he had so much control over that community. Nothing would happen. We can't even get into the 911 calls and the verbal and written threats and threatening to fucking shoot her family, like text in text, and nothing was done. So this is all she's having, you know, these first couple years of marriage, I imagine it was a nightmare. And in 2021, we can't even get into this, but there's an entire side story about this woman named Susie, who many people allege, this is pure speculation, that she started having an affair with JP in 2021. He is sleeping with people throughout every marriage, throughout every relationship. He is just everywhere. So this woman, who is a member of the church, and him apparently or allegedly starting an affair, she's seen in all the pictures. Any of the pictures you've seen of him that look shady in the days surrounding Micah's death, where he's like laughing and eating sushi with a lady, it's this lady Susie. I can't even get into this entire side story, but let's just say it involves Susie's paraplegic husband accidentally rolling into a pool and drowning after Susie and JP had been noting to spend a lot of time together. I'm saying it could be a total accident. He had been a paraplegic for a long time. It doesn't make a ton of sense that he would suddenly just roll into a pool, but like, what do I know? You know who oversaw, what do you call a person who officiates a funeral? It's an officiant.
A guy.
You know the big guy over Susie Skinner's husband? Yeah, it was John Paul Miller. And during that memorial service for this woman's husband who fell into a pool and drowned, JP starts off his show or preach or whatever in the memorial by saying he's, quote, excited to be preaching at this funeral.
Excited?
Yep.
It's a tragedy. He had to have been like, how much you push your husband in the pool?
I don't know, man. It's weird. Maybe it was truly an accident, but it seems to have happened just very shortly after their alleged affair started with this guy's wife. So whatever.
This is messy.
I mean, not whatever. I feel terrible for that guy. But again, there's no evidence. It's been deemed an accident. So years are going by. Stuff's not good in Micah's life, in Micah's world. It's becoming more and more apparent to the people around her who love her. In October of 2023, Mica files for divorce for the first time. While JP's sermons have always been extremely fucked up, actually, let's just give a like a nice sample of.
Yeah, what does this guy even preach about? Like, what's his what does he talk about?
Yeah, I wish he did it in that voice. But if you want to play the JP sermons video.
I got some people I would love to see torn to pieces by some bears, okay? I have some enemies. I'd like to buy them a ticket to the zoo and just pray and see what happens, you know, when they get by. Anybody got any? No, am I the only one that has an enemy in my life? Jeez.
See about it. I ended up selling my General Lee just to please those ladies. They ended up leaving church a few weeks afterwards anyway. I could have run over them with my General Lees. I should have done. But anyway, I thought, okay, whatever.
The lion or bear turns on me, I grab it by the throat and I beat it to death.
What?
Which, that's how you handle cats. It says it in there. Anytime there's a lion, anytime there's a cat coming around, here's what I do to the cat. I'm just telling you. I have killed cats and bears.
So Samson went out in Judges 16:1. He went to Gaza and he saw a loose woman and went to her. Because the lust was in his heart. And here's the funny thing. How can you tell a loose woman just by the way she looks? That's very interesting to me. Samson could look at a woman and tell whether or not she was loose. Let me tell you how. If she doesn't wear a bra, if her bathing suit in the back barely covers up her crack, and if every picture on social media is either in a bikini or showing off her chest, that's how a man can tell if a woman's loose. So if your daughter dresses like that, I don't want to say be ashamed because that's not godly. If your daughter dresses like that, you need to be convicted of it and teach her how to be a modest girl and a modest woman, because every unsaved man in the entire world is looking to see bra, bikini thongs, and what she shows on Facebook. That's how you can tell a loose one. And every man in this room knows exactly what I'm talking about. That's why all of our faces are red right now. And so he found this loose woman. And listen, don't you...
Well, what are you going to do with loose women? Like, say if I wasn't wearing a bra. What is he proposing?
Well,
yeah, that I get raped?
He talked about the unsafe men, which is his coded way of saying, I'm going to attack a woman if I see her dressed like that. And this is so,
this makes me want to get a gun, like, to be honest. And, like, I don't want to go on a shooting spree, but I have to protect myself. Like, when does it stop? When does this loose moral stop? Like, I have to, like, have a piece on me.
And those kind of sermons are unfortunately run-of-the-mill for especially Bible Belt preachers. There are thousands of them saying this and worse. And, you know, that's another reason that I really think we need to talk about this, because do you think that the guys who go say this shit on stage just go home and are chill and cool?
No.
And normal?
Killing cats and shit? Violent predator.
There's thousands of these guys, and they are fucking put on pedestals.
Also, what is a General Lee? He said I was going to run him over with my General. Is that a truck?
I don't know. It sounded like Robert E. Lee or something.
Dukes of Hazzard car with the, you know, the rebel flag on the roof.
Oh, and yeah. Some women in church were like, we don't like that because it's a terrorist symbol.
Because that's a Confederate flag on the roof, and they were like, no, and he said, oh, they left anyway, I should have run them over with it. Cool. Yeah.
And what a hateful little cunt.
Yeah, like, he's the worst.
I could pick him up and throw him across the room. I feel like I could.
I feel like you could. I feel like we both could.
And I think that's another thing, like, in these kind of churches, very, like, the thinness is always preached because they don't want women strong enough to pick up a man and throw him across the fucking room, which is what
definitely. Yeah, definitely. So those are just a standard run-of-the-mill sermons that he does. But they get weirder over time as this is all happening with Mica. October 20th, oh, there we go. Oh, okay, so that's what somebody at his church was upset about, and then he wished he would have run them over instead of giving it away. Well, that's cool.
God, what a piece
of shit. Also, how much tithings did that take to purchase that car? You fuck. During this time period, so October 22nd, 2023, JP uploads a sermon to YouTube where he says he's seeing a psychiatrist for a very deep depression, has been taking lithium, and has suicidal thoughts, which to me is very strange that the medication that he's on, and obviously has been off and on of for a long time in his life, is the very same medication that Mica needed when they got married. Mm. Very strange to me. Couldn't possibly be projection, could it?
Or maybe he wanted just extra pills, so he signed her up for that shit, too, and he took hers.
There is hopefully, we'll get into this, but hopefully people looking into the facility she was kept at and the people who were giving her medication. During that sermon, he was saying he's seeing a psychiatrist. This is after she filed for divorce. Mica is in Kenya serving a mission because this is something she's very passionate about. It's not something I agree with. I don't have to agree with everything to be very supportive of this woman and think she's a very good person. She loves serving the people in Kenya. So she's out doing that when he gives this sermon about the depression. That December, which is last year, JP signs his house over to Solid Rock Church. There is also a paper trail of him moving other assets out of his name, presumably to try to prevent Mica from receiving any part of their shared estate. The bar that the pastor co-owns, because yes, he co-owns a bar, gets turned over to his son during this time. So as she's filing for a divorce, it seems like his first motives, the things that he wants to take care of, is making sure she doesn't get any of their shared estate.
After she raised his kids, basically.
Worked for free in the church, helped him run all the businesses. He wanted to make sure she didn't get any of that. So she put it, he put it in different people's names into the church, and so he put that bar in, under his son's name. And it's unclear, I should say, if it's the son who has already personally accrued some domestic battery charges of his own in
God,
his
that
marriage.
Whole family sucks.
So then we get to 2024. To try to, again, list off all the threats, police reports, 911 calls, texts, emails, with JP openly admitting to a number of crimes, is something we just don't have time for on this show today. Suffice to say, they're openly available online. You can find them publicly listed everywhere. You can. It's mind-blowing how many things he's done to this woman and her family. During the fall and winter of last year and early into this year, 2024, Mica had moved to a different church. So as she's filing for divorce, she's very religious and spiritual still, and she wants to find another community in a church somewhere else. So after Micah's was discovered deceased, this video I'm about to play, I believe, happened right. What her friend is talking about was happening during this separation period at the end of last year. If you want to play Mica friend video.
Team. So I she am a volunteer member of the Super Church Cool West Chick team. And a little over a year.
We bonded
and a half
super
ago,
well right at the start because with I was also going through South Carolina. Like, very.
Oh. I don't know what went on.
Maybe
with
when
that.
It was recorded, there were two things playing at once.
I don't know. That
but,
was weird.
Yeah. Mica herself did a lot of testimonials that she put on Facebook and talk about how her, you know, her walk with Jesus.
So, yeah, I don't want to play that audio because it's something's wrong with it. But that's essentially Micah's friend from her other church, who she went, the church she went to when she was in separation with JP. And this friend posts this video after Micah's body is found, essentially saying she opened up to me about everything that had happened. And long story short, in that video says he's responsible for this and she deserves justice. That during the time period when she got away from him, this woman and her spent a lot of time together, and she heard a lot about Micah's life, basically. And that Mica was an amazing person. She was not unstable. She was loving, happy, a big part of the church community immediately, and everybody loved her. Very stable.
Yeah, she sounds like a lovely woman inside and out that this corrupt man got a hold of.
Yeah. So in February of this year, Micah's application for divorce is dismissed. In that video that Micah's friend put up, that new church was very stunned to hear that Mica was going to return back to JP in that time period, because they had known a lot about him. However, if we know anything about cycles of abuse and manipulation, she was in this cycle of, oh, he has done all this work on himself and he's promised he's gonna do things different.
He said he's sorry, so I have to come back. And you're kind of used to him doing some bullshit next. You know, it's almost like when you go back to this, you know where the bullshit's coming from.
Totally, yeah. And the people in this new church were really stunned and sad, but they were just like, we're so happy for you. And this friend herself shared her text where she said essentially to Mica, I'm happy for you. I hope he remembers what an incredible woman you are, because she didn't want to push her on it, right? You can't, right. When somebody's in like that, you sometimes can't rationalize them out of it, right?
Because if you say, like, don't ever go back to them, they're never going to speak to you
again.
Yeah,
they'll just cut you off.
They'll just cut you off, and now it's even harder. And I think she's a divorced woman who's, like, around 30 years old in this very religious, conservative place. Like, those are, like, two scarlet letters against you.
For, like, in a shithole place like this, yeah, yeah, for sure. So basically, she somewhat reconciled with him during this time period. However, whatever is going on with them, something goes wrong pretty rapidly. So the sermons become more and more sinister over time, right? As all of this stuff is going down, and he's acting more and more erratic on the pulpit. And then February 4th, John Paul preaches a sermon on how it's wrong to rise against religious leaders. On February 6th, Micah leaves a voicemail to John Paul that has now been made public. And it is basically her doing a fawning thing, what I think it is. It's a really long message. I don't know if we have time for that right now. But basically, Micah is saying in it, hey, I'm so sorry I ever left you. I should have never abandoned you. And then says, I don't even know who my husband is because I don't have a paper trail. I don't have a copy of my marriage license and where it was filed. And I just don't know how to even file my taxes, essentially. And this is her trying to get him. He has taken all of her documents from her.
She has no money. She has nothing. Like, she doesn't know how to file taxes. She's been in this church as a child. Like,
so after she returned, mm-hmm. he essentially took all of her shit. Took away her way to escape. So he does this manipulation. She comes back. He steals all of her documents. February 6th, she basically sends this email trying to be kind in a way, being like, you're so beautiful. I'm so proud of you. It would be, you know, I don't know how to, if I don't have my paper, I don't know how to, you know, file taxes and without knowing, because she wants her documents. He stole everything that she would need to leave. So that's February 6th. February 8th. Micah is involuntarily hospitalized in a mental facility by JP. Note, this was after she asked for a paper trail. So she's asking about where, you know, all of the stuff's been moved out of their name. Her stuff's been moved around. The church has bought their house. Like, she was asking questions, and then he forces her into hospital, saying that she was threatening to take her life, using that as an excuse.
I'm sorry.
Yeah. It's...
She's just backed into a corner. Like...
The hospitalization, as well as her mental health diagnoses and the medicine she was being forced to take, I find it extremely curious. Again, that she would need the exact same medication that JP required for his mental illness. Who was giving her this medicine? Why was she diagnosed with the ailments immediately after she was married to this man? And going off of feelings, again, I do not believe she was schizophrenic.
No.
Which is what JP and only JP alleges. By February of this year, 2024, their contentious relationship is already being made public by Micah's family. Her family is progressively getting more involved because this is getting really dark. February 15th, Micah's sister posts, if you see any post, message, or text from my sister, Micah Miller, it is not her. She doesn't have access to her phone, email, Facebook, none of it. You can see from her posts who's actually controlling her account. She is still too scared to call him out by name because of how much power he wields.
This is before or after he put her nudes?
After. Oh, okay. No. This is not when he put her nudes
not
out yet.
Okay.
She's hospitalized as this is happening, and during her hospitalization, he is posting as her.
Fuck you, man.
From her accounts.
Posting as her?
Yes.
Just like going and be like, I'm having a great day. I love God. And she's just like in a white cell somewhere?
Yes. And sending her, like, using her phone to send text messages out and shit like that, pretending to be Micah.
Saying that she's safe? Oh, my fucking God.
So by March 10th, this is spiraling. And the sermons are getting crazy. I know we're running out of time, but I'd really like you to hear some of the sermons he's giving while he's institutionalized his ex-wife, well, his soon-to-be ex-wife.
You
it's funny, my enemies think they're going to stop me. They're actually putting fuel in my gas tank for me to keep going. Last year, you know, my wife, they went to Africa, had a wonderful trip, amazing trip, and she came back with the idea to start a school in Africa. And 6 weeks ago, she goes in the hospital, gets out, and just leaves. Just completely leaves me, leaves everything, drains the bank account, and goes. And guess what? While you're talking bad about me out there, I'm building a school in Africa for over 100 kids to be able to be fed. But if you're going to talk about somebody else, that's a demon, actually, right there. When my wife went in the hospital, you know, I looked at her phone, and I counted over the past 2 years, 18 people who had texted her and said, if you ever want to talk about your husband, you can talk to me and say anything and I'll keep it confidential. Why the heck does somebody want to hear what somebody else says about their spouse? And two of those 18 were men.
Trapped.
One day I'm going to preach about getting rich, strong, healthy, and finding a hot wife that loves Jesus. That's what I'm going to do. I'm just kidding.
He just said he's looking for
that was wrong. I told you I shouldn't be here today. I told you. A friend of mine that's a pastor called me last week, and one day on a Monday, his wife told him that he was the greatest husband in the world, that she loved her life, and she was so appreciative. The very next day, something happened, and she left. And he didn't know where she went. She just left all of her things, left everything she had, everything she worked for, everything. He didn't know what to think. He had no idea what was going on. So he hired a third-party service to find her and see where she was living and, you know, that kind of stuff. And they did. And last week, they turned in all of their evidence to his lawyer. And he discovered that she had left him for one of his staff members, a young man that he had trained and to learn how to preach, that he had shared his pulpit with him, a young man who the pastor had paid to go to Bible college, gave him a job. He worked hand-in-hand with the pastor. And in one fleeting moment, the pastor lost his wife and his good friend all at the same time.
It's like he's using.
When he saw the information over the lawyers, he started to throw up. Just
like his first
throw up one trash can, second trash can, a third trash can, and he just started to dry heave. He couldn't believe what he saw. It was the most horrible image and worst thing you could ever imagine. The lawyer drew up the divorce papers. The lawyer told him and said, you have everything you need now. You can be divorced in 3 months. And you'll never have to see her again. You won't have to give her a dime. There's far more than enough information to take care of everything. The pastor said, give me the papers, draw them up. They got all the paperwork ready. They put the pen in his hand, and he just couldn't sign the paper. They said, but don't you see everything, and don't you understand? And he called a lot of the elders, and they supported if he wanted to leave her, just leave her. This is it. For some reason, he just couldn't do it. And so he went home and he wrote her a letter.
You can cut him off.
And all he said was,
this is just the end of that. It's just him. Obviously, if you're not following this, I think it's still probably obvious, but he's speaking in third person about himself in that last sermon.
Yeah, this guy.
Yeah. That all of that was stuff about Micah and him and his past with her and this guy that he knows who hired a third party to track the wife is him. He on record did that. He had her tracked on her car. He would slash her tires. They found tracking devices on her car multiple times. That he had a PI tracing her steps. And then at the end of that sermon, he goes into, even though his wife was this big whore bitch, he wouldn't divorce her because that's what God wouldn't want. So he makes himself this like aggrandized, like wonderful angel man at the end because of this horrible woman who's hurt his friend, who he's speaking of himself.
This is him.
It's all projection.
This happened to my, and I don't want to turn this on me or anything, but this happened to my family. So my grandfather was a pastor, and then my mother talked about her mother, and she said, yeah, she was a sad schizophrenic woman. I often wonder how sad, like, what is her life? She has no meaning. And then I found out that she used to be the life of the party. So she got married around 14, 15. My grandfather's much older, and apparently she was a hilarious, bright woman, and he would physically and sexually assault her, and then said she had schizophrenia, and then sent her to the asylum, where she basically lived at her age. And just how many times, I say this because how many times has that happened, and this has happened, and that's happened, and just these women that have been forgotten in history that were such sad, schizophrenic, nutshell of a human that used to be very bright and intelligent and funny. She's apparently hilarious.
Yeah, this did make me think of your family, and of course I wouldn't have brought it up. I think it's amazing you did, because I know that that happened in your family. And
it's just like, how many women, and you know, does this have to happen to under the guise of religion? And he gets away with it?
We're out of time, and there's so much more, you guys, and we didn't even get to... I mean, obviously, you can find all this stuff online. Please look it up. I do think her story deserves to be told over and over again. But he admitted to, in April, in writing, that he uploaded a nude photo of her on Facebook because he was mad, and then pulled it down, and the cops wouldn't do anything. They filed police reports over and over again.
Is it because, like, I imagine if your spouse is doing something, it's, like, under a different jurisdiction?
It is. I will not say entirely there's no corruption. It could be. There could be a lot of corruption going on, but there are also certain really fucked up things. Like, if you're married and you both own the car, for example, they couldn't charge him for tracking her because technically it's a marriage. Their car is owned by both of them. And
he
so
slashed
he's allowed
his own tires, I guess.
Yes. Yes. Which is why another reason that they don't want divorce to happen in these situations, because then they can't continue their little games legally. So if you want to go also find like a really comprehensive timeline just quickly before we have to go, Justice for Mica Reddit page has done a really good job of putting a comprehensive timeline together of all of these events if you're interested in going through it. Because it is obviously, that's why I wanted to do it like this way, because it's a lot of information, but it is so horrific. I do feel like we need to keep talking about this and just really, really hope that they're going to let something stick to him. Because in so many of these cases that we end up talking about, we talk and talk and talk and we're like, unbelievable. And then at the end, the law goes, that sucks. What are you going to do?
What are you going to do? I feel like we should also do an episode on how to speak to somebody who's going through this traumatic thing, like a man or a woman or a trans person in the relationship. Like, if you know that they're being abused, how do you talk to your friend and say, hey, I think you should leave?
Yeah, I think that we should talk to maybe some mental health professionals on the show, either via stream or on the main channel, and talk to them about that, because I think it's a good thing to discuss.
Yeah, just
for
some
sure.
tips.
So people don't know what to do. So many people in Mica's life wanted to help. And also, many people turned a blind eye to this repeatedly.
Well, those 18 people were just like, if you need to talk about your husband.
Yeah.
That's
can
a
you
lot
believe
of people.
He fucking said that? Also, when he announced her death on the pulpit, which we didn't even get to, goes on to say that she was mentally ill and she killed herself.
Fuck
and
him.
I tried to help her get her medicine. He is a fucking piece of shit. He does not deserve to be walking around in the fresh air. And we just want to send our condolences to Mica's family. I'm so angry. She was so young. She was just in her 20s. 30 is young. She felt trapped because she tried everything you're supposed to try in these situations. She went to the police, to people, to families, to different churches, and she could not escape this man. And so even if he didn't pull the trigger, I think some people need to be held accountable for what happened.
Exactly. And let's thanks for the subs tonight.
Yeah, we don't have any fun videos for you at the end.
Sorry. Oh, because my phone got stolen. I usually do the funny videos at the end.
But also, I feel like we need to just have this be about Mica. I'm so angry for her, and we have to fucking stop this. We have to stop platforming motherfuckers like this. Thanks for the subs, Nexus Tomahawk. You gifted a sub. Tess underscore Erzabet, subscribe for 3 months. Thank you, Zero Sue Camus, subscribe for 6 months. Thank you, Anonymous Gifters, gifting a sub. Thank you guys so much. The Weed Wife, I'm a licensed therapist. Oh, hell yeah. Send us an email. What is send us an email to someplaceunderneath@gmail.com if you want to... You know, reach out to us. We would love to ask some questions.
Yeah.
Okay.
Peace and love, guys. We love you.
Is it tears?
Oh, no. We're going to do The Brighter Side with Jackie Zabrowski.
Oh, Brighter Side. So, see, you get all of this stuff, then you stay for the smiles.
Yeah.
With my two co-hosts of my shows. All right. Yeah, we're done. Thank
we're
you.
Done.
Thanks for being here, Amber.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys. Sorry. There's nothing happy at the end of this.